Remember the golden rule. Remember the golden rule. You sit when you're told to sit. Right? Let's bow our head for a word of prayer. Our gracious and loving Heavenly Father, we come before your holy presence in the name of our dear Lord Jesus Christ this afternoon. Thank you for being with us these past 2 days. Thank you for speaking to us this morning through your dear servant. Thank you for making your ways known to us, Lord. Now we are gathered before your presence one more time this afternoon. Lord Jesus, your dearly beloved children have come from all over this nation and also from afar off to hear what God will speak to this nation particularly, and thereby those who are from afar off can draw principles from there and thereby learn what they should do for themselves and for their nations. Now I ask you, Holy One of Israel, the Lord Jesus, who is meekful and lowly of heart, give us a humble heart right now to hear with all humility what is at stake before us and what you are calling us to do, that we may unite our hearts together in all humility and in contrition to implore your mercy and your favor. And we pray that hearing our prayer of contrition and seeing our broken heart, you may pour out the spirit of supplication and grace upon this great nation, that it will be flooded with your love and with your goodness, Lord. Lord, your word says, one shall put 1,000 to flight, and 2 shall put 10,000 to flight. They are more than 2 in this congregation, Lord. Certainly they can put many millions to flight. You will only do that when you see all hearts united together in oneness and in brokenness. So now we invite you, Lord Jesus, to come and speak to us and make your ways known to us. In the name of our blessed Lord Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. Please be seated. I was pondering very much before the Lord what I should come and share with you this afternoon. And while the worship was going on, I was just reminded of one thing. You know, we have gathered here for this conference at a very important period of history in Australia. But the dates of this conference were planned last year, way before this crisis that is looming before your nation. So, God who calls the end from the beginning, knowing what crisis you are going to face at this point of time, call for the put in the hearts of the leaders of this conference the dates, the exact dates prior to which you're going to have or face a crisis, so that you can hear what options or choice God puts before you, like a way of escape. You know, throughout history in the Bible, whenever God speaks of judgment, or God warns of an impending judgment to come, He always gives you the reason why He's chastising or disciplining. Secondly, He also makes a way of escape. How you can escape from all this. So He puts all that before the people. The options are always there. You can avert the whole thing, or you can just do nothing about it and just be swept away by the tide. There are some judgments that you cannot do anything about it. It has been determined and it will certainly come to pass. There's nothing you can do about it except saving yourself. A good example of this is found in the case of Sodom and Gomorrah. You know, Abraham prayed so much, but the judgment that was determined upon Sodom and Gomorrah came to pass. The city could not be saved. However, because of the intercession of Abraham, and also because of the righteous lifestyle of Lot, only he and his family were saved. The rest of the city, twin cities, not just twin city, no, there were actually 2 + 5. So there were altogether 7 cities, of which Sodom and Gomorrah were the most famous, or kind of they were the fathers and the mothers for the rest of the 5 cities to fall into gross sin. So all 7 cities were destroyed by fire that came down from heaven. But Lot, his wife, and his 2 virgin daughters were safe. But then there are also cases where an entire judgment over a nation is totally averted. A very good example of this is Nineveh. You know, and you heard a wonderful message from Brother Neville on the second session, that because God had already prepared the nation through famines, through plagues, through a solar eclipse, they were scared to death. They were rather prepared through scaring. That is also the goodness of God. Scaring, you know. And so when Jonah came, this natural disasters has already prepared the way for the message of Jonah. He was the last person. When he blew the trumpet, the whole nation repented. And therefore, the judgment that was to come upon Nineveh was totally averted. Jonah was Nineveh's last chance. If they had not paid heed to Jonah's message, Nineveh would have been totally destroyed, like how Sodom and Gomorrah was destroyed. You know, eventually Nineveh was destroyed as Jonah had prophesied, but not after 100 years of grace. In the same manner, God extends grace to some nations. One particular nation that is enjoying God's grace at this point of time is the United States of America. That is why God has given them a president, a man after God's own heart, Mr. Trump. You know, he may be rough in his speech, unmannered, uncultured, different ways of talking like how we talk. However, he is a very prayerful man. He's a prayerful man, godly man, God-fearing man. And you know, when he took office, the first thing that he did was to clean up the White House. And they discovered during the 8 years of the presidency of Obama, there were many, many idols that were brought and kept in the White House. Many, many hundreds of idols of different religions, Hindus, Buddhists, you name it, everything. And he cleaned the White House of all the idols and restored prayer in the White House. See, he is God's man. And God has given the nation 4 years of grace. 4 years during his presidency. 4 last years of grace. To put their house in order. Now this is the very message that I shared in the US last August. At a conference at a place called Moravian Falls. 4 years of grace. If they clean their house, if they put their house in order, that grace will be extended for another 4 years. Because each American president can serve for 2 terms. So another 4 years. So 4 plus 4, 8 good years. More than the 7 years that was given to Egypt. If they don't put their house in order, then the 4 years or lesser that the nation will go into captivity. Now, you have before your eyes U.S. as an example. But even in this captivity, I mean, even in these good years, when we make wrong choices, God disciplines the nation. See, like for example, 2 years ago, I was leaving Los Angeles airport to go to Houston. And a mighty angel came and stood beside me when we were standing in the airport. And the angel identified himself as the angel of United States. And he had a huge sledgehammer in his hand. He was so gigantic in size. And he said, "We are going to strike this city with an earthquake." Strike means strike this region, mean the Californian region, with an earthquake. And when he spoke that, I saw hundreds of angels lining up in a line all over the Californian region with sledgehammers ready at a given notice to bang on the ground. And when they did, there will be a massive earthquake all along California. 6 months later, Hollywood released a movie called San Andreas. The very place that I saw the angels were going to strike for a massive earthquake. And then he also told me that 3 other places have been predetermined, pre-selected for earthquakes to rock the nation. 3 places. And I don't know which are the 3 places. The only one place I know was California. And this will be massive earthquakes that will break the nation apart to pieces. I mean, the whole continent of US will cease to exist. It will break apart in 3 pieces. And the Atlantic Sea, ocean, will all flow into the hinterland. So I was scared and trembling when I received this word. And all throughout the journey, from Los Angeles to Houston, a journey of 3 hours by flight, I had no peace. I was so troubled by this prophecy. And I kept on praying and asking God, why, Lord, why? And when I landed at Houston Airport, as soon as I came out of the plane and set feet on the soil of Houston, the word of the Lord came unto me, this city will be attacked, will be destroyed by a massive flood. Now, I was already saddened and sick by what I heard in Los Angeles. Now, I'm hearing another worse thing. So I thought to myself, I must be a very bad luck person. Anywhere I go, I'm not bringing any good news. I'm only bringing bad news. Must be very bad luck, isn't it? No? It's good luck? Anyway, so in the meeting in Houston, I shared what God showed me about the great destruction that's going to come to Houston by a flood. And you know what happened last week. According to the word that was spoken, the entire city of Houston was flooded. And the news media is saying it will take years for Houston to be rebuilt again. It will take years. Not months, years. Now, we have these warnings before us now. Now, Australia, East and the West. You know, there is a spiritual connection between United States and Australia. I don't know whether you know this or not, but there is a spiritual connection. What happens in the West has a counter effect on the eastern part of this world in Australia. You know, both are on two extremes. Australia is on the far east of the world, and US is on the far west of the world, from one end of the world to another end of the world. You know, one amazing thing, in our television network, we have launched 12 channels that cover the whole world in 8 different major languages. When we first started, it was just one channel that we beamed our programs into India. And then 3 years later, in 2008, we launched a second channel to Europe, so that all the people in Europe, not only the Indians living there, but also the Europeans will hear the word of the Lord. The following year, when I was praying, the Lord told me to launch 2 channels. He said, one in the US and one in Australia. Why connect the two together? He said, from one end of the earth to another end of the earth. Launch 2 channels at the same time. So, 2 years later, in 2010, we launched 2 channels, both in the English language, to these 2 continents, in Australia and in North America. And just as there is a large gay movement in the United States, likewise, you have a large gay movement in Australia. There is a spiritual connection between the two. You know why? Because both these continents are gateway continents. One is the eastern gateway, another is the western gateway. Both are gateways. And when both are, something begins in two, when it stretches out its hands to join, it covers the whole world. All the nations of the world. So this conference, we are gathered here for a very, very strategic period of time. All of you are like Esther. Or this conference is like Esther. You know, among the many words in the book of Esther, the most prominent sentence that we all know too well is the sentence, "For such a time as this," complete it, "you have come into the kingdom." Likewise, for such a time as this, this conference is organized. And listen to the words of Esther. When Mordecai told her to do something about it, she feared for her life. She said, "I can do that." Or another way to say is, like she couldn't be bothered for what is going to come upon the nation. She, "I can do that." And Mordecai was very upset with her. And he turned around and he told her, see, he was a no-nonsense uncle. He never means his words. Mordecai did not pamper his niece. She was like a daughter to him. When her parents died, he brought her up like one of his own daughter. But now, he stood like in the office of a prophet and he rebuked her very sharply and sternly told her, "Okay, if you don't want to do anything about it, fine. But remember, when we all go down, you will also go down. When we all die, you will also die. Don't think you will escape just because you are the queen. Don't think that." So in the same manner, if the law is passed for a yes, all of you will fall. So please don't forget that. You know, most Christians have a very conceited view about themselves. They always think that we are better than everybody else, that we are beyond the touch by Satan, even by God. You know, that's what we think, you know. We think that even God cannot touch us. Because we, like what we always say, we are covered by the blood. Nothing can touch us. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. You see? You sing that song. So, we have a deluded mindset that nothing can touch us. Not even God. No angels can touch us. You think like that. See, when the nation of Israel went into 70 years of captivity, righteous Daniel was in captivity. Righteous Ezekiel, righteous Ezra, righteous Nehemiah, righteous Jeremiah, they were all in captivity. These are all righteous men and women of God. They were all in captivity. When the judgment falls, even the righteous will fall. Of course, God will preserve the righteous. But you go into 70 years of captivity. Now suppose the vote is yes. Let's look at the negative side first. Suppose the vote is yes, and then your parliament passes the law. Okay, same-sex marriage bill is passed. Not only same-sex marriage bill will be passed, do you know that even the educational system will be changed? That all your children, from small, they will be taught that there is not only a father and mother, but there is also a father and father, mother and mother. You know, A year ago, I was very shocked to see some emoji cons in the iPhone that has the icons of a family, father, mother, children, and then the other icon is father, father, mother, mother, and children. I took several looks at that to see if my eyes playing tricks. And when I looked closely, they were promoting a gay alternate lifestyle. So now you can send an emoji cons to promote that. And in Europe, in one nation in Europe, it has become mandatory from January 1 of next year that all the school system will teach the children from grade 1 about this alternate lifestyle. Can you imagine your little 6 and 7 year old goes to school and comes back, looks at you, Pastor Paul and Mrs. Paul, will look at you with a strange look and ask you, Father, why mother is mother and not father? Don't laugh. This will become a reality. Or it will look at Mrs. Paul and say, Mommy, why father is not mommy? Pastor Andy, your son will come back and ask you this question, right? So what will you answer your kids? They will be indoctrinated in their schools. What will you do? So the next generation are going to be indoctrinated to accept or be part of an alternate lifestyle. This is not only, this is happening in Europe, already started in the US. You are next in the list. Not only you, Taiwan has become the first nation in Asia to have passed the same-sex marriage bill. First nation in Asia, a conservative Asian nation. And China is next in line. Singapore is next in line. India is next in line. You know, in Indian parliament, they are now debating. They have already passed the transgender law. Transgenders now have equal rights as any other ordinary citizens. And transgenders have their own toilet now. Male, female, and question mark. See, these are all becoming realities. Just as what the Lord Jesus had warned us, as it was in the days of Lot, so shall it be in the last days. So this is a sign that these are the last days. So what are we going to do? The scripture says, righteous Lot vexed his soul. He kept himself pure. That's all he did, you know. Kept himself pure. Sat at the gate of the city and cried every day for the sins of the land. He was not like Noah who went and preached righteousness. He did not do that. He just took care of his own soul. That's all he did. So what are we going to do? The whole of yesterday afternoon, the committee has been deliberating what they will do. Now, before they come and share what they will do. So this morning, as I was waiting on the Lord gave me a few things to share with you so that you will know what is required out of you. This is called, or my message is entitled, The Urgency of the Warning. Noah, during his time, was warned of an impending judgment that was going to come upon the whole world. So he was warned. Now, why of all the people in the world was Noah chosen and he was warned? Why? Genesis chapter 6, verse 8 and 9 tells us why. Because of two reasons. One, he was perfect in all his generations, which tells us that when there was an intermingling of the spiritual seed and a human seed, his generations were unspotted. His entire generation, his lineage, there was no corruption. He was pure and clean. Number two, the scriptures tells us he walked with God. So he had a personal relationship with God that was very strong. That was healthy. It was not a relationship that he only did when he was, when he felt like doing. Pastor Jose made a statement earlier. He said, those of you who want, can go to our book table, pick up a form and to be a prayer partner. You can pray whenever you feel like praying. That is not walking with God. Whenever you feel like praying. When you walk with God, you have a consistent walk. See, when there is a father or mother in a family, the children, when they look up to you, they don't look up to you as father and mother whenever they feel like calling you father and mother. Right? You are always a father, you are always a mother because you are always being a father and a mother. It's not like you switch off being a father one day and you tell your child, don't call me father today, call me uncle. Today I'm an uncle to you. Or today I'm an aunt to you. Then the following day, 2 days later, you switch on the button, said, now you can call me dad because I'm a father to you today. Do you do that?